Hey, Jamar here. From Buffy. Buffy wants to talk to you too. See, hey, Buff? Yeah? Okay, so in my last video about called the Codependent's Pain After a Borderline or Narcissist, I thought of something else that was really, I think, a great teaching moment and hopefully will help others. From the commenter that I was responding partially to in the video, of course, video wasn't all about that, and I'm hoping to help as many people as come by to watch. So that might need to hear this message. So what I was touching on in the last video that I didn't really expound upon, the aspect of what that commenter had said about, you know, the last part of the comment was, because, you know, how can I, you know, tell someone they might have BPD and everything, but like the reason why codependents externalize things like that to meet a need of their own and many unmet needs of their own, instead of taking personal responsibility to meet your own needs if you're codependent, right? Which is, you know, something I mean with empathy, because you have learned, you know, unfortunately through your childhood experience, you know, to not be able to, you weren't put first by a parent in one way or another, and now you don't know how to put yourself first. It's very difficult. So, but the point I wanted to follow up on was that they'd said what they wanted to do and why, which is a codependent frame of mind and externalization of secondary gains, like I said in the last video, that they didn't want their ex or their friend with BPD to split and have negative feelings about them. And I just wanted to say, and cause negative feelings about them, I believe was the word usage. And so I just thought I'd follow up my last video with this video to say, really important for people. See, because here's another thing that happens for codependents, right? And people are empathic, but codependents are empathic too, obviously. But you end up, many people end up feeling like, or perceiving, that they caused, you know, someone to feel bad about them, that they caused somebody to do A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, you know, the whole alphabet and more. That a codependent person can be like, well, but why did they have, why did the borderline narcissist have to do this or that? Why did they do this? They were so, you know, mean and cruel, and this hurt me and that hurt me, and I don't want them, not that everybody's the same, but a lot of codependents will be somewhere inside thinking, well, I don't want them to think badly of me. Or even when you've had enough of them, there's still something you're missing. There's still something that hurts so bad. And it has a lot to do with unresolved feelings, yes, from a relationship with a borderline or narcissistic ex. But more to the point, unresolved feelings that have nothing to do with them at all. So there's the unresolved feelings after you've been, you know, in a relationship or any proximity to a borderline or narcissist. But what about all those unmet needs from your childhood for those who have codependency? Which I just want to go on record again saying, I don't think it's a self-love deficit disorder. I think it doesn't have to be pathologized. I think that definitely people need to learn a lot more about self-love. But why haven't codependents learned that? What is that about? Is that like you got some pathological thing? I don't think so. It's called, you know, what happens in childhood, no matter if it results in codependency or BPD or NPD or various other issues that people have, and fear of abandonment, fear of rejection, fear of betrayal, children, most children, most of us don't get out of childhood without some level of emotional, unmet emotional need, unmet emotional needs. And if you get parentified, that's another key way that people end up developing the roots of codependency in childhood. Not being seen, not being heard. So, you know, you're usually looking to help in some way a parent so that they can help you, which is the beginning of the seeds of codependency and that sort of setup of, Or the trap, you know, of I need to give to receive. I need to really work hard here for my parent or whoever it was in your childhood. Usually it is a parent. I can't get their attention. I can't get my, I'm not being seen. I'm not being heard. I need to try harder. I need to do better. There's something wrong with me. They're not, you know, paying enough attention to me, or they're really busy and like, don't I count? And that's just some of it. I mean, sometimes it's trauma. Sometimes it's even more, it goes deeper than that. But sometimes it's a parent who's just emotionally unavailable. Doesn't have to be a borderline or a narcissist parent. It often is. But so at the heart of codependency, this pattern that you carry into adulthood, many people do, that is so painful, it leaves codependents thinking and feeling and believing without sort of, which this would all be very highly emotionally driven, right? Not rationally, really. But you may, but these, some of these thoughts could be subconscious. It leaves codependents feeling like they are responsible for how other people feel, for what other people, not always, right? Not everything a borderline or a narcissist would do. But it leaves codependents feeling like they just need to try harder, because it is, you know, a repetition compulsion from childhood, from something in your childhood where you sort of got the message in one way or another, maybe really overtly, maybe not so, maybe more subtly, that to be seen, you really had to work hard. You had to maybe change who you were. Some people will end up feeling very much like left out and alone and victimized by that in childhood. Other people will try to be the hero. Other people will try, like, super achievers in school. And, you know, I can't tell you how many clients I've had and have now with codependency, working through that healing and recovery process, that realize in their childhoods just how some of these things happened to them. Working so hard at school, trying to be the superstar athlete and or get great grades. And no matter what they did, you know, the need to be seen, that need to be heard and validated, to be interacted with, to be related back to, mutuality and reciprocity is not there, or it's not there enough, but it's often absent for people who develop codependency, which develops in childhood and then carries forward. Because if you weren't receiving what you needed just because you were there and needed it, and somebody was, parents are supposed to love you and support you, and we all know that doesn't often go well at all, or it goes horribly wrong, then how do you reframe now for yourself how worthy of this that you are now, and how much that the journey is about you finding that nurturing parent part of yourself to really reparent your inner child and work on that internalized internal critic, inner critic narrative that you grew up with, that can form a lot more of your perceptions in life, your feelings. And, you know, people are, I don't want to say trained, but the result of what happens to people in childhood who develop codependency in childhood and going forward is you didn't get really important needs met. You know, maybe there was a lack of nurture, but lack of validation and not being seen and heard. Maybe parents were too busy. But you learned in childhood, if you have codependency, to some degree or other, that your needs didn't matter, and that you had to do something, give more, lose and sacrifice yourself to try to pursue getting what you deserved in the first place. And this is what people carry on in adulthood. And so whether, you know, when people are with a borderline or a narcissist who are codependent, I mean, people don't develop healthy enough ego boundaries with this kind of situation in childhood, which happens to just so many people. And again, the overlap of that between people with BPD and codependents, of all the things that don't happen for them in childhood, though there is a difference, right? Because people with codependency don't really have emotional arrested development. Just a lot of, you learn a really maladaptive pattern of believing that your feelings don't count or that you're not worthy of having your needs met unless you perform, you know, get someone's attention, give extra, try harder, rescue, people please. You know, it's so difficult. And I don't know if there's, you know, when people have codependency, there's various gradations and levels of that, and I think, and degrees, rather. And I think that, you know, do we ever get 100% not codependent? I don't know about that, because I'm still working on that. I don't usually have, you know, but I gave an example on live stream the other day, I don't know if I would say I was being wholly codependent, but yeah, it was sort of like a little bit, there was an element of a little bit of people-pleasing in there, because I think, you know, so anyway, you can come a long way, right? And that's what's important. And certainly shoring up any, ego boundaries and then working toward identifying boundaries, or if you've identified boundaries, then how are you going to not only communicate them or assert them when need be, but how are you going to enact them? Again, boundaries in action, especially with cluster Bs, is often more what people need, you know, and especially with codependency. So I just wanted to follow up on that point from the last video that I didn't about, as well as what I've added here, I guess, but about the fact that, you know, as a codependent, I think people really often feel and grow up believing or being told that the reason that a parent doesn't feel well or that a parent's upset, it's all your fault. You did it to them. Then if you end up in a relationship with a borderline or a narcissist, you've already been primed for that in a way, which is tragically unfair and not your fault. But again, your responsibility to change for you now. Why? Well, because you can only change yourself, number one. But number two, because you're so worth it. And so it's these inner critic narratives, too, from childhood and codependency that are very strong that, you know, people aren't aware of it consciously. But, you know, I work with a lot of clients on this in codependency recovery, and people come to realize what are my beliefs? What are the negative core beliefs? What is that voice that is my internalized inner critic versus, you know, where am I? And that doesn't mean that you don't know who you are. But it just means a lot of people don't realize how much the inner critic or the critical parent or the parent that wasn't able to meet a lot of your emotional needs, perhaps other needs as well, left you in a position of having a certain idea about how to relate, what you need to do in order to, I guess, basically, it's like a transaction of you need to do more for someone else to earn their love, to earn their time and attention, to earn empathy, to earn whatever, you know, plethora of needs and other things people don't get in childhood. And that's just, you know, a distortion. It was a painful thing that happened in people's lives with codependency. But it's such a distortion now, you know, and it might have been a reality of a parent, especially if you were parentified. And you had a parent that was cluster B maybe, and they just, you know, were taking from you. So codependents don't learn from childhood on up, don't know the landscape of mutuality and reciprocity, because I think it's fair to say that to one degree or another, every person with codependency, and which develops in childhood, has experienced broken mutuality and broken reciprocity. And it's also an experience that very much affects the way that people are attached, and not the same way as people with BPD, but codependents, the way that they will attach and what they're doing and why, and the secondary gains, as I mentioned in the last video. But, and then there is this subconscious belief, sometimes people will even express it in different ways, that you continue to feel like you triggered the borderline, or you did something that made the narcissist rage, or, you know, many people are in these places or have been, you know, and that's a codependent cognitive distorted mindset that is often, like I said, not conscious. So it's really important that you know that, you know, if someone with BPD or an ex is you know, like narcissists discard you, whatever, or person with BPD splits you and they're being negative, or they have a negative view of you, well, that's where, you know, you need to work on, well, ego boundaries to begin with, but boundaries, because why, I mean, it's understandable why, from your childhood, people with codependency experience this, but it's so important to know that you're not responsible for anybody else's feelings, because that's what children who develop codependency from childhood experiences and in childhood and onward in life keep going with that, of course, because it's a pattern, it's a learned pattern that you need to unlearn. They really just believe that, you know, that you cause other people to feel however they feel, that they then impose upon you in an overbearing an overbearing way, that means there's no room there for you or your feelings or for you to be seen. And I think this is why codependency is a very, very painful thing. And some people try to minimize it. Other people try to say, oh, I'm not a codependent. I'm an empath. I'm not a codependent. Well, they're not mutually exclusive at all, whatever people want to define empaths as, because people have a high degree of empathy. The term empath is becoming so overused. Maybe some people are preferring to just say empath versus codependent. And not that, you know, labels or terms matter as much, but knowing the landscape of what the patterns and what it really means to the pain that you're in and why, and how you need to change that. And so again, you know, if you are still around somebody, or you still are with somebody with a BPD, or you have an ex and or a narcissist, or a parent with BPD or NPD, just know that you truly, really don't cause them to feel how they feel. And you're not that powerful, and you're not responsible for anyone else, how they feel. And you're just responsible for how you feel and the unmet needs that you need to learn how to meet for yourself, to esteem yourself, like and love yourself, focus on yourself in a healthy way, and grow boundaries, learn boundaries, enact boundaries. And it's not easy. It's not like you can just say that or intellectually understand that and make it so. It's about becoming much more emotionally literate. It's about the EQ, not the IQ. The IQ is good. You have the awareness. Now it's time to enact building up the emotional literacy, getting more in touch with your feelings, and understanding that you're not responsible for how anybody else feels, what they can do or can't do. You don't have to be there to fix and rescue. You don't have to be there to people please. In fact, all of that, as I think a lot of people with codependency know, even if they don't know it yet, it's bloody painful, because it comes from the roots of codependency in childhood of broken mutuality, broken reciprocity, often failed empathy, and also not being seen or heard or validated. And you were made to believe, or you strove so hard to get needs met, to be seen. You were made to believe, with an emotionally available parent at best, or a cluster B parent at worst, that you were made to believe as a child. You were trained to believe that you needed to make up for this. And the harder you tried, and the more you would fight and try to make up for it, then surely you would be getting something back. And many people with codependency are still stuck in that repetition compulsion, truly not realizing in an emotional, like in a balanced emotional intellectual way. So in your EQ and emotional literacy, and in your IQ, many people, more so the EQ and the emotional literacy, many people still are not aware of what's subconsciously driving this continued codependent pattern. And it's so painful. But just know, if you have codependency, A, it's not your fault, and this is not victim blaming, and B, you are not responsible for how anybody else feels. You don't need to fix it. You don't need to change it so that you can feel okay, so that you can feel better. That's something that happened with a parent. That's something that took place in childhood. And so you need to learn more about what that means in your life and work through those repetition compulsions and those very painful patterned ways in which you now continue subconsciously, perhaps not knowingly, denying yourself mutuality and reciprocity by being involved with people that are similar to what you experienced in childhood with your parents. You, as a person, but people with codependency really need to hear this, I think, you're not responsible for how anybody else feels, but you're so responsible for helping yourself. And you so deserve that. And that's healthy. And you're responsible for how you feel. And I'm going to have another video coming about what happens when the borderline and the narcissist tries to reconnect with the codependent. And how can codependents help themselves there? And what's that narrative about? What is that narrative about? Sorry. And how so many people are, again, in an unconscious, non-mindful, not really emotionally understanding place of, again, what are repetition compulsions for codependents and the externalization that I talked about in my last video. So please know you're not responsible for anybody's feelings. You're not responsible for helping them with anything that they either need to learn or that they should be able to do on their own. And you are responsible for your feelings, though. And it's time to focus on you, and it's time to get in your own healing and recovery journey. Or if you are, continue that and learn how to refocus. And I help clients do that all the time. And I'm going to have some courses coming, as I keep saying. And, you know, I don't know how long it's going to take. I'll let you know when they're ready. But learn to refocus on your own needs, because that's what you are responsible for meeting. Your own needs now, in a way that likely a parent or parents never really met for you. Broken mutuality and broken reciprocity, and it leads to demystification, and that leads to trauma bonding and something that people call love that has absolutely nothing to do with love. And I'll have much more coming on that too. And I hope that was helpful. And as always, take care of yourself. And you can't make anybody feel anything, and nobody can make you feel anything. And that sounds harsh maybe to people, but you really are responsible for what you feel. And when codependents get that, they'll realize equally they are not responsible for how someone else feels. Take care now.